Gospel according to St. Mark, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, and dug a pit for a wine press, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the season came, he sent a slave to the tenants to collect from them his share of the produce of the vineyard. But they seized him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And again he sent another slave to them, this one they beat over the head and insulted. Then he sent another, that one they killed, and so it was with many others. Some they beat and others they killed. He had still one other, a beloved son. Finally he sent him to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But those tenants said to one another, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they seized him, killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard. What then will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. Have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. When they realized that he had told this parable against them, they wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowd. So they left him and went away. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Well, this is not the sermon I was going to preach, not the sermon that I had prepared for today, but as you know, these are extraordinary times. Like you, I am watching the unfolding of the coronavirus pandemic. Cities in some countries, like Italy, are quarantined. Large gatherings are being canceled and now shut down by orders of state and federal government. Schools are closing, including all schools now in North Carolina. There is no March Madness basketball. There are gatherings. We are asked to not have gatherings more than 100. And some are saying no gatherings more than 50. All of this in an effort to flatten out the curve of the rate of the spread of the virus. So here we sit today, called be the church, a small gathering, sitting 6 feet apart for a short, no-touch service. We are indeed called to be the church. However, being the church is not always, certainly never only, about gathering for worship. Matthew 25 speaks of the least of these. Not in some derogatory manner, not in some name-calling fashion, but in a caring and supportive and loving way. Jesus saying in that parable in Matthew 25, "When you did it to the least of these, you did it to me." That population, the least of these, it seems to me, is who Jesus would have us think about as the church. Again, this is not the sermon that I was going to preach, not the one I had prepared for today. I was going to talk about Mark's version of the parable of the tenants. It's in Mark, Matthew, and Luke, and we have read, and we're going to talk about Mark's version in some depth. It is a tough parable. It is a wonderful parable, much worth our time. But given the state of emergency all around us, I'm going to bring the ending of the sermon I was going to preach right here, pretty much the start this time. In the parable of the tenants, we see evidence of human violence as the owner keeps sending servants, keeps sending messengers. It is the sent ones in that parable, those who are servants, messengers in the parable, that I invite you to identify with today. messengers of God. We are ambassadors of Christ. That's all familiar enough language for most of us. But what does this begin to look like when the novel COVID-19 virus is declared pandemic? When a national emergency is staring us in the face? What does being church look like in these extraordinary times? The invitation is for us to help define what being church looks like. We're going to step away from our building. We're going to step away from our usual pattern of gathering for worship. And we're going to find ways to be the church in these extraordinary times. Let me name just some initial ideas that I have. Check on people, especially the vulnerable population, the lonely, the fearful, the least of these. Schools are canceled now for at least 2 weeks. The parents may still have to go to work. Can you help a friend who has a child by doing some child care? Could you shop for someone who is in the higher vulnerability categories? Someone over 60, someone with an autoimmune disorder, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, irritable bowel syndrome, severe asthma, so that they don't have to go out and be at further risk? What about internet access for a student who has nines at home? That's the case for many of our school children, even for some of our college students. Could you call some people, particularly those who are often lonely and struggling? Could you send cards? Could you do prayer with someone over the phone? Could you help curb fears? Could you help curb false information that is getting spread? Could you help be a calm presence even in a high anxiety time? I'm sure you will have other ideas to help us learn and continue to be the church in this time. As I pondered this myself last night, Galatians chapter 5, verse 6 came to mind. Paul, in that chapter in Galatians, is talking about freedom in Christ. And then he speaks, in verse 6, of faith working through love. Or as one translation puts it, faith active. We citizens of the world are being asked by state and federal and national agencies not to gather in large groups. And our bishops, North Carolina Western Conference of the Methodists, the Episcopalian, our own bishop of the North Carolina Synod of the TLCA, bishops across the denominational lines are encouraging the churches, congregations, follow this advice as well. We are not being asked to stop being the church. I want you, the leadership of the congregations and the churches, want you to help us find ways to be the church through this. Support one another, help the least, and put the gift of faith into action through love. The sermon I was going to preach on the parable of the tenants in Mark 12 named the horror of the violence. Ignoring, beating, killing the messengers of that vineyard owner in Jesus' parable. And then even killing the son of the vineyard owner. The violence in Jesus' parable was about greed and a grab theology of inheritance is about a person, Jesus. In the parable, Jesus quotes Psalm 118, "The rejected stone has become the cornerstone." We gather at church because the crucified Christ is that cornerstone, because the crucified Christ is the living Lord. We can also be the church during these extraordinary times by not gathering, by not gathering. Our inheritance is Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus is our peace. Christ Jesus is